Anyway, thanks for coming here tonight. It's a great turnout. Thanks to the Mirro Center for allowing us to use this awesome facility. For those of you who don't know me, I think I know almost all of you, but my name's Tom Dykstra. I'm a member of Professional Emergency Physicians. Been there about 22 years and been involved with EMS around Northeast Indiana for much, if not all, that time. I got a great group of physicians that I work with, PAs, but that's not why we're here tonight. I come here tonight representing the EMS Foundation, who was kind enough to put money towards, well, a little bit for you, but for everything else to make this happen. So I'm very proud of that, and I'll fill you in a little bit on what that is, because most people don't know, even people within emergency medicine and within EMS. So let me start with that. The EMS Foundation was a foundation started to essentially for medical oversight for Three Rivers Ambulance Authority. And it was set up by a group of physicians and continues to be run, if there is such a thing, by physicians. It's all volunteer. So there's 10 physicians that sit on the board, and it's rotated through the groups. I saw Dr. Million, I saw some paperwork from like 1700s and his name was on there. So these are the kind of people, you know, that mentored the rest of us to come through. So things that happen at Three Rivers Ambulance don't just happen by accident. We find things, we look at things, best practices, research, and this is how I became associated with Dr. Spaite. And we bring things forward, and then we look at it at a protocol level or for equipment and things like that. And everything's voted on, discussed and voted on. So just so you know, that the care that's being given at Three Rivers Ambulance and diffuses through the Northeast Indiana is watched over very closely. There's also a portion from each transport, a small portion from each transport that TRA does that goes into the foundation. Those monies are earmarked essentially to try to, for the betterment of EMS, for lack of a better term for that. It was those monies that allow this conference to occur, to have some good food, to get all the announcements and things like that to be put out. Also, we've put together EMS scholarships. We were able to send two people this year just to the Eagles Conference and cross paths with some people out here that also went, which is an amazing conference, 2 days, rapid fire, about 20 minutes a pop. And it's a good way for people that haven't been exposed nationally or internationally to get a taste for what's going on out there. Also for National Association of EMS Physicians that will come up, which is it's open to everybody, any EMS providers, but it is the primary group is EMS physicians. And there's, pushing 900 members in that of physicians worldwide. And many of the things that you have become accustomed to came out of there. When CPAP showed up here, it all started there, and a lot of the care and equipment that we use. So that's where the foundation sits. The other thing that it's gotten us involved in is research. There wasn't much of that done. It's been an area of interest for me since I started doing quite a bit of it around 2006. It's allowed us to get two publications in pre-hospital emergency care, and Pat Dugan and Dr. Amy Gutwein, Tom's daughter, were able to present at two different conferences. So our name, Northeast Indiana TRA, has been put out there internationally. So we're on the board a little bit with that, and we've done some really good research. So that kind of goes over what the foundation is, just so everybody knows a little bit more about that. I always want to just say thank you to the people that are out there, most importantly the volunteers or the people that were volunteers and still are, because they're the people that don't get paid and they take time away from their family or friends or whatever it is to be out there to help. And I was just making a list of all the people to thank, and I really ran out of the room for that, including the police and the TRA employees, as well as the people out there, all the regional providers, the educators. I mean, you have so many people that are involved in giving pre-hospital emergency care, and I thank you all for that. Just a small thanks to Gary Boer. He's the executive director and has been for years at Three Rivers Ambulance. He can't be here tonight because some family things going on, but he really kind of keeps us all in check, and he's a great historian and is helpful with all the governmental things that go along with that. Rob Smith's here. I know I saw him, and chief of operations. There he is in the very back. So, and I thank him also. So that kind of takes us to, I can't read any of my notes. there's that uncomfortable pause. I guess we'll just go right forward to, so is that NMSP, I'll tell you about 4 years ago maybe, Dr. Spaite started talking about EPIC. And anything about EPIC I knew was that was a computer system that had come in. And he started talking about traumatic brain injury, and he started talking about looking at all this data sets that he had and information. When we all, you know, kind of speculate about things, he had the data to show what was going on and how we could impact that. And that really caught my attention. One thing I will say, most importantly, about NEMSP, about Dr. Spaite, is this is data-driven. This is not this worked for me here or this worked for me there. And all of us that have been around a while, we've seen things change and then they go back to the way they were. And we think something new comes and they go back to the way they were. And I've not seen that once I've become involved with people that are really looking at best practices and following and quality assuring what they're doing, looking back to make sure it works. So I was duly impressed. Then he is one of the speakers at the National Airway Conference as well, and gave this talk or something similar to it at that point a couple years ago. And then I started working on you to get you here. And when I picked him up, he said he's in the 4 million mile travel club. So he travels all over the world giving this, giving these talks. And I just can't believe we got him here. So I feel we're blessed to have that, and I'm glad so many people are here to see this, and please take this information as you see fit out there. So let me tell you a little bit about Dr. Spaite, if I can read this. Come on up, because I'm getting old. And these are some of his credentials. Dr. Spaite is a tenured professor in emergency medicine at the University of Arizona College of Medicine. At the University of Arizona, he holds an endowed Virginia Piper Distinguished Chair of Emergency Medicine. During his career, he has pioneered many aspects of the young discipline of EMS systems. He has published more than 150 original scientific articles and 250 scientific abstracts, has presented his research in out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, trauma systems, cost analysis, evidence-based EMS guidelines, and analysis and modeling of EMS systems at hundreds of conferences internationally. He has written numerous seminal papers related to the development and the modeling of EMS systems and research and EMS comparative effectiveness in research. He has been responsible for bringing over $15 million in research grant funding, has won many national research awards. In 2010, and I was there, he was awarded the Ronald Stewart National Association of EMS Physicians Award. It is the highest honor awarded by NEMSP. And is given for outstanding contributions in pre-hospital care and the development of quality EMS throughout the world. In 2015, he received the Outstanding Contributions in Research Award from the American College of Emergency Physicians. This is the highest honor bestowed by the college for a research career in a specialty of emergency medicine. So to show you, that was the first paragraph. And there's another and another. And then the big paragraph, I'm not gonna read them. I think that just a little bit that I was able to tell you about them is the credentials. But I think most importantly, he cares about clinical medicine and how we can change that. I think what you'll see tonight will challenge you, and hopefully we'll be able to take that and implement it out in our care and give the best care that we can give. I think the greatest compliment to us is how each time I see him, he's like, boy, you got a lot of people really invested in EMS around here. And people that came to his lecture yesterday even came back today at TRA. So with no further ado, Dr. Spaite, I'll let you come up here. And thank you all very much.
Thanks, Doug. Something like a third of what he just said about me is actually true. I'll let you figure out which third it is. Yeah, another good crowd. Wow, I think you've had probably over 300 in the four sessions. So who here are primarily EMS providers that are basic life support level tonight? Raise your hands, hi. Okay, how about paramedics? Okay, how about respiratory therapists? Yeah, even we had a good group last night too. Physicians? Any trauma surgeons? They're different than physicians. It's easy to talk about them because they're not here. And nurses? And how about people involved in flight EMS? Okay, good. So it's kind of everybody. Because I'm, as you said, I've spent my entire career at the University of Arizona, 32 years now. What I love the most is I've been an EMS medical director all that time. 32 years ago, you didn't have to know anything to be an EMS medical director. You just had to be willing to be the doctor that would sign something that they handed you to sign. So I was fortunate enough, I didn't have to be smart. I just had to make it up as I went. So one of the things that's really been true about EMS is we know so little about EMS that if you discover anything, people like all over the world think you are amazing. So I discovered a couple of things, and people all over the world think that's amazing. So we know something instead of nothing in EMS. But as you will see tonight, there is enough from animal and human physiology, from general critical care research, and from EMS research to put together an amazing readjustment that needs to happen in the focus in emergency medicine. Because I'm tenured, unless I do something illegal, nobody can fire me. So it's really fun being at a point in your career where you can say anything you want, they can't kick you out. I've got my day job, so you can't. If you kick me out, it doesn't matter here. Right now, the reason I go places to talk is to do one of two things or both. If it isn't either going to change the way you practice or make you mad or both, it's not worth me taking the time. And tonight, I'm going to make all of you mad. Even the respiratory therapists will be mad after tonight. But it will, I think, challenge all of us. It's been a wake-up call for me. I'll just start by saying, you'll be amazed at how many people I've killed inadvertently in my career because we didn't have a clue, but what we're putting together now is a major game changer. Disclosures, basically only one. I've been in academics all my career, so I'm not smart enough to make money and sell stuff. You know, we just find it, put it on the free website at the university, and you can, go to epic.arizona.edu, and you can have all the master trainer stuff and the PowerPoint slides and all the papers and everything you want for free. And I have no relationships that are pertinent to this at all with industry, and that is actually intentional. Industry doesn't even buy me lunch because we did not want to do any of the statewide stuff with any risk that it would be perceived that somehow we're after pushing some widget because we own stock or something like that. So I have nothing to disclose at all, except the NIH is funded. I'll talk about the EPIC study, Excellence in Pre-Hospital Injury Care, repeatedly tonight. That's funded by two large R01 grants from the NIH. Of course, that all goes to the university. So it's a real scam being a university. EPIC is really a game changer. What it is we have over 125 agencies in the state of Arizona that over the last 4.5 years has been the implementation, but over the last 8.5 years, we have all of the data linked, imagine this, linked to trauma center outcomes in 98.3% of the cases. We have the EMS data linked to the final outcome data. That doesn't happen typically in studies with a couple of hundred patients in EMS, let alone 21,000 now major traumatic brain injury patients. And what the study is it's a before-after system comparison of what happens after the statewide implementation of the traumatic brain injury guidelines, which, by the way, you can either read the 82 pages or listen for the next 20 seconds. This is the EMS traumatic brain injury guidelines. The three H-bombs. You aggressively prevent and treat the three H-bombs. Hypotension, adults age 10 and greater, a systolic less than 90. So remember, aggressively prevent and treat. So don't let them get below 90. You'll see some of the numbers of why it's so important to prevent hypotension. And in fact, by the way, EPIC's probably going to change what we think hypotension is. Hypotension and traumatic brain injury, by the way, might be 120. It's that dramatic. And you'll see why. Tonight, you're going to see why the injured brain is desperate to be perfused. And that changes everything about ventilation and probably changes everything about resuscitation as well. But aggressively prevent and treat hypotension. Sorry, I already went more than 20 seconds. I keep rudely interrupting myself. The second H-bomb is prevent hypoxemia. Don't let the pulse ox go less than 90 at any point. And you'll see, again, the dramatic numbers of what happens when it does, even one time in the field. And then, if there's a tube in, or as you'll get good at tonight, when the second part of the session, when we actually fiddle with the flow-controlled bags and so forth, as you'll see, if you're doing positive pressure ventilation, either basic or advanced through a tube, aggressively prevent and correct, if you've already done it, hyperventilation. Those three H-bombs, preventing them, we believe, are likely. By the way, the EPIC study is 8.5 years in. We just opened the black box. We don't know what the outcomes are. You can't do that, right? It's cheating in a real study. It's cheating if you keep looking. You can only look at the data twice. At the interim analysis, all I can disclose is at the interim analysis, it didn't get shut down for either harm or futility, which is rare in traumatic brain injury. So the data looked good enough to continue the study until the final analysis, and we're now doing the final analysis and hope by the end of 2018. And just because of your connection with Tom, he'll be one of the first people who know, so he can let you know what we find. So here are the objectives. They're pretty simple. Discover the forgotten essential in the airway fray. We'll spend the first 20 minutes or so on that. Shift from the focus of the tube as a procedure. It's all the focus, right? It's all about the tube. It's all emergency medicine. I did not get into emergency medicine to drain abscesses. I did it to go home and say, honey, I've been married for 39 years. Honey, today I was doing the Lord's work, saving lives, putting tubes in, and, you know, putting tubes in all the holes they have and making new holes and putting tubes in those. And I was, you know, I mean, it's just, aren't I amazing? Don't look so pious. Some of you do that yourselves. It's all about the procedure. And you're going to see how bad it is for the patient when we're all about the procedure and not what happens after the tube's in. And then recognize the universal problem of inadvertent ventilatory inattentiveness. I'll come back to that. And it will surprise you. And then to prevent the intubation hyperventilation paradox, which is I'll come back to this. That tube that you're so proud of is actually a murder weapon. You will find out, now it's second degree, you didn't mean to. Right? It's not intentional. It's not pre. You didn't mean. But after tonight, it will become first-degree murder. So here we go. So I'm going to start the first. But everybody will be mad by the first couple of slides. So that's my full intent. You won't sleep. You may not like it, but you won't sleep. Ventilation really matters. This table over here, it's going to feel really good for a while. And in fact, its importance is so profound that this is actually how the ABCs should look. You know, your classic concept of the ABCs, mine, it's all wrong. It actually should be, this is almost an afterthought. And it's all about the breathing. And as you're going to see, the breathing has an unbelievable impact on the circulation. In our setting, not doing it right, almost all negative. And unfortunately, as you know, ever since Johnny and Roy, anybody old enough that actually watched it not on Nickelodeon, you actually saw the original, yeah, okay, you're willing to get your age out there. Yeah, Dixie and Rampart General, it was amazing. Now, by the way, remember, we'll come back to this, it was an hour long in 15-minute increments. And how many people did they save on every single show? One in every 15 minutes. And ever since then, we've all believed that's what we do. And you're going to see, actually, Johnny and Roy were killing four people per session, and we've been killing them too. And the reason why is, you can barely see the B. And amazingly, the B done right saves lives amazingly, and the B done wrong really hurts people badly. We met at the National Airway course. NAEMSP, National Association of EMS Physicians, has had, for three decades, has had a national airway course. Now, with the exception of the respiratory therapists here, who has ever heard of a national ventilation course? And the reason why is they would never have a national ventilation course because nobody would come, right? And here's why. Did I put it up here? Yeah, first of all, ventilation isn't cool, right? Who ever got to the end of the shift and everybody's around the station high-fiving and saying, man, did you see we did perfect ventilation for 18 minutes? We were amazing. No, you're congratulating whoever passed the tube through the cords is who, you know, everybody buys dinner for them. Okay, so, and ventilation is really boring. So the B is the ugly stepsister of the ABCs. It barely shows up on the ABCs, and the reality is, the bad news is, this ugly stepsister is a killer. You're going to be amazed at some of the science that you see tonight. I suspect very few, if anybody, has seen all of what I'll show. The EPIC study has a major focus on if there's positive pressure ventilation, doing proper ventilation. We'll actually go through the details of that and show you the flow-controlled bags and all that kind of stuff. But this is a recurrent theme. EPIC has been great in the state of Arizona because here's where I start making some of you mad, the hospital-based people. In the state of Arizona now, trauma surgeons, respiratory therapists, nurses in the emergency department, even paramedics that work in the emergency department are all getting schooled by the basic EMT who comes in with an intubated patient, still with their monitor, watching the end-tidal CO2, flawlessly doing two-finger gentle squeezing so that you can't even see the chest moving with an end-tidal CO2 of 40, and they say to the respiratory therapist, go get your ventilator. I'm not going to let you screw up this person's brain cells with bad manual ventilation. It's really an amazing reversal. They have so gotten it in EMS that EMS is schooling the trauma centers in, this is really embarrassing, in the 22-year-old in-hospital guidelines that the trauma centers still don't do. Why? Because we're all about 100 miles an hour, hair on fire, doing procedures and congratulating ourselves for doing a thoracotomy. Who in the world's gonna care about ventilating right? Okay, so, let's see. This is gonna bring a tear to some of your eyes in EMS now. So if the A is done perfectly and the B isn't, we really hurt people. You're gonna see some amazing data on this, right? If the A is done perfectly and the B isn't, we really hurt people. If A is done perfectly, this is where it starts getting provocative, and the B isn't, then it should change what you did with the A. Let me just put it out there. If your EMS system isn't ready to do B really well and verify it, then you shouldn't graduate to advanced airways. If you're gonna do the A advanced and not do the B right, you should not do the advanced A because you're going to kill more people than you are going to help, by far, more data to come. So doing advanced airways is a downgrade. How's this? Everybody knows advanced is better. You're gonna see, no, it's not. It actually isn't. It's actually a downgrade from BLS if you don't do post-intubation ventilation really well. Okay, why? The three bad players, some of this is gonna be new information for some of you. These are all bad players. Positive pressure ventilation, more detail in a minute. Hyperventilation, meaning breathing too fast, and overventilation, we'll go into the difference between hyper and overventilation in a minute. And all of these, notice, as soon as you put a tube in, you now can drive a truck through that tube. So all three of these really bad players become really easy to do once you think you've saved a life by putting a tube through the cords. So here's the three bad players. Positive pressure ventilation is really bad for sick patients. Okay, this is the short list. There's like 12,000 bad things about positive pressure ventilation, okay? The good news for you is I only have an hour and a half, so this is the short list. It increases intrathoracic pressure. You're going to see how bad that is. It decreases venous return to the heart. You're going to see how bad that is. It decreases mean arterial pressure, which you should already know is bad for the brain, in any sick patient, not just traumatic brain injury. It decreases cerebral blood flow. It decreases coronary blood flow. By the way, those are the two reasons why we do CPR. And we're ruining our CPR with positive pressure ventilation. That's why in Arizona you don't get intubated or bagged until 8 minutes now. We'll come back to that. You know, your compression-only CPR, that's the new thing out of Arizona. Let me show you how slow we are. In our pig lab at the University of Arizona, 25 years ago, we knew that if you have a set of pigs that you induce VF in, and they arrest, and if you do just chest compressions and you let them choke on their tongue on room air, that's your A and B, okay? Room air, no, not doing anything with the airway, not bagging, not breathing, for 10 minutes, and you just do good chest compressions, all of them live. The next day, they're neuro, yes, you get tenured for doing neuro exams in pigs. It's the Arizona state dollars at work, tax dollars at work. They're all normal, happily eating. Don't even know what happened. And the next day, if you did, at that time, flawless ACLS, tube in, ventilator on, everything perfect, they all died. It took 15 years to have a medical director in the state of Arizona to find out that only 1 in 50 cardiac arrest patients in Arizona survived. This was 12 years ago. 2% survival in the state of Arizona. So Ben Bobro realized we couldn't kill anybody else. Everybody's dying. So what we did was we translated the pig lab into the EMS system of the state of Arizona, and in the last 11 years, we have quadrupled survival in the entire state. No place in the world has ever done anything like this. Because, guess what it is? We knew 25 years ago in the pig lab that it is, now you all know, of course, God said A, B, C. It's the one commandment in EMS, right? You go to EMS hell if you don't get A, B, C. Well, guess what? It's the CABs. They already have a lung full of air. When their heart stops like that, what do they need? They need to circulate the oxygen that's already in the bloodstream. Duh. You're going to see a reversal tonight. But in any case, I want to show you, the reason why I went through that was to show you how we've been in the midst of questioning everything we do in the environment of the Arizona EMS system. Everybody's in. 93% of the patients now that are cared for in the state of Arizona get minimally interrupted cardiac resuscitation, compression-only CPR. Nobody does even positive pressure ventilation, not even bag, until 4 cycles, 8 minutes of CPR without positive pressure ventilation, just high-flow passive oxygen. And it's been associated with a quadrupling of survival. Anyway, okay, so what's wrong with positive pressure ventilation? I want you to think about it this way. God made the cardiovascular system to work properly when air is being sucked, not pushed into the chest. Now, think about this. Respiratory therapy, I'm going to blow up your entire science now. Because, think about this. Unless you've gone to the OR for a procedure, or unless you've had a really bad event, there's not a single breath in your life you have ever taken from all the way back to the first one that was pushed into your lungs. Not one. You come down the birth canal, this amazing thing happens. It gets really tight, the chest is squeezed, all the amniotic fluid is squeezed out of the chest, and what happens? All of a sudden you get this huge explosive expansion of the chest when the baby is delivered, and the chest goes shook, and what's the baby do? And fills up with it, and every single breath all of your life has always been relative, it's not negative pressure, of course, there's still almost an atmosphere of pressure inside the lungs, but relative to the external, it is always, every single breath we ever take, and we are meant to take, is always sucking air, not having air pushed into us. Positive pressure ventilation is bad. So notice, the reversal of the negative pressure dynamics of ventilation messes almost everything up. So when we congratulate ourselves for the really nice ICUs and everybody's sitting around on their ventilators, these beautiful new expensive ventilators, and have all these beautiful numbers and stuff, we're congratulating ourselves for messing almost everything up because we're using positive pressure ventilation. Now, right now we don't have a good alternative, but let me really shake you up. Positive pressure ventilators are a major downgrade from iron lungs. Now, none of you were alive. I wasn't even alive when the nation had tens of thousands of iron lungs for polio patients, right? And how did iron lungs keep polio patients alive? Actually, the right way. You're stuck inside of this iron lung, and what happens? The iron lung has a negative pressure, which then expands the chest so that they suck air in rather than having air pushed in. Now, the problem is we still haven't figured out how to create that iron lung dynamic and still be able to have access to do all the rest of the stuff, right? We still have to put in central lines, and we still need access to their arms and legs, and we need to be able to put in chest tubes. So the reality is, but if we could figure out a way, think about this, in the ideal world, endotracheal tubes would be used only for airway protection. Yeah, if they're comatose, you want a tube in to protect them from aspirating, but you know what? In the ideal world, we would not push air into that tube. There would be some way that we could create a relative negative pressure in the chest so that air would be sucked into the ET tube. Everything about positive pressure ventilation is actually bad for patients. It's better than dying, but in some cases. Notice, okay, so positive pressure ventilation is bad. And hyperventilation, so this is really bad for patients. This is too fast. Again, there's a gigantic list of what's so bad about hyperventilation, but let me just point out the two. First of all, it increases intrathoracic pressure. What happens when you increase intrathoracic pressure? It worsens all the negative effects of positive pressure, and as you know, it can lead, if you're going too fast, even if your tidal volume is normal, even if you're squeezing the right amount, you can end up stacking. This is even in non-COPD, non-asthma patients. You can end up stacking pressure upon pressure because you're spending so much time inspiring because you're going too fast. In fact, in some EMS systems, I'll show you some of the studies, some EMS systems, the average post-cardiac arrest, post-return of spontaneous circulation, intubation, ventilation rate manual is over 40 a minute. If you are doing normal tidal volume at over 40 a minute, you are stacking pressure upon pressure, and it's really bad for patients. And, of course, going too fast, even if your tidal volume is normal, increases the minute ventilation. So just to remember back to whatever school you went to, the tidal volume is the amount of volume that you put into the lungs in one breath. That's the tidal volume. Minute volume is the total amount of volume that you do in a minute. So if you do the right tidal volume, but you double your rate, then you double the minute volume, and then, as you'll see in a minute, that dramatically decreases in CO2, which is really bad for all kinds of things, but especially the brain. Okay, so the reality is, this creating the hypocarbia, this is bad for all sick patients. Now for a moment, for the really esoteric part of the crowd, and maybe some of the obnoxious physicians by me, you'll say, yeah, but what about aspirin overdose? Okay, I'll grant you your two cases in your entire emergency medicine career that has metabolic acidosis with a pH of 6.8 so that you have to hyperventilate them long enough to give them bicarb so they don't arrest. Okay, now let's set those two patients aside and let's talk about all the rest of the sick patients we take care of in all of our career. Positive pressure ventilation and hyperventilation and hypocarbia is bad for everyone. Every single sick patient we take care of, not just TBI. So let me show you what happens here. This is pig data. Here's ventilation rate with normal tidal volume. So this is done with a ventilator. So every single breath is the right volume for this size pig. But look what happens between a ventilatory rate of 5 and a ventilatory rate of 40, which is the average in some systems after they get the tube in. Notice what happens to the intrathoracic pressure at 40. Now, okay, so 17 or 18, let me put that into perspective. If this is a person who has ongoing CPR and is intubated and is being ventilated at 40, even if the volume isn't too big, which is rare, as you'll see when we go through this, it's rare not to also be overventilating. But let's assume they're doing exactly the right tidal volume. You lose 17 or 18 millimeters of mercury, and does anybody know what the typical good systolic blood pressure is you're creating when you do really good chest compressions? About 30. 30 is pretty good. So notice, just by simply going too fast, you've wiped out half of the blood flow, of the pressure, excuse me, you wipe out more blood flow than that, of the pressure. You've wiped out half because you've increased the intrathoracic pressure. And remember, in fact, we still, a lot of people now believe that the actual thing, you know, the old idea of you're squeezing the heart and it has valves, and so the valves make it go the right way, that may be a relatively minimal factor. The reason why you get forward flow is probably because, and this is probably why the single most important parameter about chest compressions is actually how quickly you release. What does that do? Quick release sucks blood into the chest and into the heart so that with the next push, it will create forward flow, okay? So increasing intrathoracic pressure is exactly the opposite of what needs to happen in a sick patient. Okay, so this is bad. This is a really big deal, and this is even assuming that the tidal volume was correct. Okay, sorry, this is a little messy, but this is really instructive. So this is Tom Afterheide's work. Some of you, if you've done any cardiac arrest science reading ever, Tom's all over it. Tom's a giant in resuscitation research, a good friend, does amazing work in Wisconsin. A cardiologist kind of turned emergency slash EMS physician. This is 12, which was at the time the AHA's recommended bagging rate, 12 per minute, for patients who are in cardiac arrest with ongoing CPR that have a tube in. And he did 30 because he actually did a bunch of video evaluation in his system of how quickly, on average, they were bagging patients in cardiac arrest. And it was 30, okay, in their system. And so he went to the pig lab, which they've done a huge amount of amazing science in the pig lab there. And so notice what happens to intrathoracic pressure. It goes from 5 to what? It almost triples. And this is coronary perfusion, by the way. The two reasons we're doing CPR is for coronary perfusion and cerebral perfusion. Okay, that's the two reasons we do it. That's how it takes fine VF and turns it back into coarse VF, is because you're actually perfusing the heart. That's why we do it. Notice what happened. You lose a significant amount of coronary perfusion pressure with the right volume, but the wrong rate. Just hyperventilation, not overventilation here, just hyperventilation, okay? And then, look what happens to survival. You go from 85% to almost all the pigs dying. And the only difference is doing the right way versus doing how we do it. You know why in most systems cardiac arrest is still cadaver lab? The reason why is, in most systems, we do this. And guess what? This happens, that happens, and that happens. See, the B is the ugly stepsister, but the B is the most important thing we do, and it's forgotten. We're going to see that as a recurrent theme. So in the swine model now, look at cerebral perfusion. Remember the other reason we do CPR. This one is not in CPR cases, but the vent rate here is at 6 or 12, okay? And then there was a third arm that I'll get to in a minute. So even for the basic EMTs, and by the way, after this, I'm hoping your medical directors are going to say, yes, you, in fact, you're the one who primarily needs to be responsible for knowing how to deal with entitled CO2 and to yell at everybody when it's wrong. More on that in a minute. Here's 0 to 60 for the entitled CO2. Normal is 40. In the EPIC study, the target range is 35 to 45. The target is 40, but the range is 35 to 45. And notice, at a respiratory rate with normal tidal volume for the weight-adjusted normal tidal volume for the medium-sized pig, if you're at 6, this pig is slightly underventilated, if you will, from the perspective of entitled CO2. Okay, see, notice the average for the pigs is an entitled CO2 of 47, a little bit on the high side. Okay, that's at 6 with a normal tidal volume. This is at 12. It drops from 40 to 30. Remember that number of 30 when I show you the outcome studies related to how sensitive outcome is to entitled CO2. And really remarkable is the third arm was do this with very carefully controlled tidal volume manually, but do it so that you adjust the entitled CO2 monitor to stay at 40. And there's two remarkable things about this. One, in the right environment with one person focusing only on doing right ventilation and keeping it at 40, notice it's right at 40. And the other thing to notice is these are confidence intervals. This is a 95% confidence interval. So this number, while it's 47 in the mean, notice there's a 95% confidence that in any given pig, it would be within that range from about 40 to about 53, right? That's the range, because nobody was, it wasn't that all the pigs were 47, it was a range. This was the mean, okay? And same thing here. But notice, if you do it right and pay attention, they were essentially always perfectly 40 with no variation. That's how well this can be done, even with manual ventilation, if you're not distracted. More on that in a minute, because that's actually impossible, which is why we have to have widgets that force us to do it what we like to call the right way, instead of the way we're doing it now. Okay, so look at this. Remember cerebral perfusion? Look at this. Start with the pigs that stayed at 40. Cerebral perfusion is, in this setting, during shock, was actually almost normal. Okay? And amazingly, look at this. In fact, back to this. It's possible that the guidelines someday will say that the target is actually slightly higher. We're going to come back to this, but when CO2 in the blood is slightly higher, you get slight vasodilation, further vasodilation of the cerebral arteries, and you actually get increased blood flow to the cerebral arteries. Okay? When you get low CO2, you get vasoconstriction. More on that later and how devastating that is to the injured brain, that vasoconstriction, and how incredibly sensitive it is to changes. Okay, so notice this, though. So this perfusion is actually not on average, you know, pretty wide confidence intervals here, but on average, in this group that was slightly under ventilated, which has never happened in one EMS patient anywhere in the world with manual ventilation, slightly underventilated, they actually have slightly better perfusion to the brain, okay, and then you got this great perfusion, and look at this, just a change from 40 to 30, and I am embarrassed to say, the number for the first 20 years of my career that I had entitled CO2 but had not put this together, I'm embarrassed to say the number of patients that I took care of that I thought 30, no big deal, it's 30, so it's 30. 85% of the blood flow is lost to the brain with just going from a low of 35, right, the range being in here, to 30. It's worse than that. I'll show you from Dan Davis's work in San Diego soon. But look at this. 85% of the blood flow of the brain is lost for a mere trivial drop in entitled CO2 to 30. And then this is the brain oxygenation, which really matters the most. Okay, the reason why you care about cerebral blood flow is getting oxygen to the brain cell, right? That's the real kicker and real killer. Sorry about the offset, the PowerPoint version. I obviously did this too old PowerPoint, but the bottom line is Look at this. You lose almost 90% of brain oxygenation with an end-tidal CO2 of 30. Anybody ever seen an end-tidal CO2 of 30, or am I the only one that realizes my whole career I've been hyperventilating and killing brain cells and I didn't know it? That's why I said it's second-degree murder. I didn't mean it. I hope I retire before they catch up with me. This is from the San Diego RSI trial. Let me give you just a little bit of background on it since you don't know it. So RSI, rapid sequence intubation, this is an NIH-funded randomized trial where patients with bad traumatic brain injury were randomized to either RSI and intubation or basic airway. The PI was, the principal investigator was Dan Davis, who was not the medical director of the system, is a colleague of the medical directors of the system, but was the medical director more on this of only the air medical part of the system, but this was all, both ground and air that was involved in the study. And let me just point out, okay, so here, you already know this now. This is the CO2 by the arterial blood gas that's the first blood gas upon arrival at the trauma center among intubated and non-intubated major TBI patients in San Diego during the study, about 1,100 patients, okay? So this is the first CO2 level that the trauma center gets, okay? And as you know, these are the normal ones, 35 to, in this case, 44. And notice, blue is non-intubated, and red is intubated, and the people in the back actually get a better effect than I do. Look at this. Look at the blue versus the red. Wait a second. I thought advanced saves people. No, advanced with bad basic actually kills people. Look at the load of red over here. And we're going to come back in a minute to how unbelievably bad this gets in terms of outcome when you're on the left side. Really, really dramatic. Okay, so another example of pig data. I'm just kind of giving you a little travel log here of, okay, so here's arterial CO2, 40 would be about here. And notice in the range that we're talking about here, down to the high teens, right? Notice how much of the cerebral perfusion you can lose. You can lose more than half by doing this wrong of cerebral perfusion. Okay, and here's what's amazing. Among the 1,100 patients, when Dan looked at the intubated patients, which is about 600 of the 1,100, this is how sensitive the brain is for mortality, okay, for the final outcome. Now remember, this is just pre-hospital CO2. This is just the effects of CO2 from the pre-hospital, which in San Diego County, I think their average on-scene intervals were about 6 or 7 minutes in major trauma, and their average transport interval to the trauma center was about 8 or 9 minutes. So this is maybe 20 minutes of care, okay? But notice, Dan is able to identify statistically significant greater mortality, and this is adjusted for all the things, this is in the regression model, so it's adjusted for all the things that affect the outcome, like age and injury severity and all that kind of thing, with increments. So if the patient came in the 35 to 45 range, if they came in their lowest CO2, this is, by the way, their lowest CO2. This isn't their average CO2, it's their lowest CO2. If their lowest CO2 is 32, they're statistically more likely to die than if they were 35 to 45. And if it was 29, they're statistically more likely to die than if they were 32. And if they're 26, the increments of 3, you ready for this? Go all the way down to the low 20s, and you know what happens at the low 20s? At the low 20s, it doesn't matter whether you're 22 or 17 because everyone was brain dead who ever had a CO2 in the low 20s in the field, no matter what else happened. No matter what the trauma center did, no matter what the neurosurgeons did, no matter what anybody did, if the field allowed the patient to ever be in the low 20s or lower, 100% of them died or were brain dead, so they had, you know, they could be a donor, basically. That's how powerful what you do, and this is a good time for me to break this out. If you are an EMS provider, If you're a respiratory therapist, if you're a nurse in the emergency department, what you do dwarfs the impact of the neurosurgeon. Dwarfs it. And let me give you the data on this. The neurosurgeons wined and dined themselves for like 2 years after this study that came out in the New England Journal of Medicine about 15 years ago. And what it showed was it was really very striking. It was an impressive study, top study, made it on CNN, made it in USA Today, all the stuff. Everybody was all the talk, and here was the scoop. In traumatic brain injury patients who have intracranial bleeds that need to be emergently removed neurosurgically, if patients got neurosurgery in less than 4 hours after the injury, they were 20% more likely to survive, adjusted again, 20% more likely to survive than if they got the neurosurgical procedure after 4 hours. 20%. Okay, you ready for this? The best studies in EMS and emergency department where the resuscitation is going on, right? EMS and emergency department. The best studies have showed this. Patients who get intubated with traumatic brain injury in the pre-hospital setting or in the emergency department who subsequently have proper ventilation, right? Preventing hyperventilation, overventilation, back to that in a minute, and preventing hypocarbia. So no CO2 lower than 35 at any point. You ready for this? The people who have hyperventilation, overventilation, or CO2s below that as a group are 6 times more likely to die. 6. You ready for this? Do you know what that percentage is? 600%. I love doing neurosurgery grand rounds. Again, I'm tenured, they can't kick me out. So I love having a room full of neurosurgeons at the university doing their grand rounds and saying, you know what? One live brain is worth a room, is more valuable than a room full of neurosurgeons. The reality is, here's how it is. If you don't do it right, they can take clots out till the cow comes home, and they're never going to bring the neurons back. What you do dwarfs the significance of the neurosurgeons. And what's really scary is this stuff we don't care about because it's not a fancy tube that we congratulate ourselves for. This is really important stuff. Okay, overventilation is really bad. So overventilation is, this is a little bit streamlined. It can be more sophisticated than that, so don't run me out, a respiratory therapist, because you know it can be a little more complex. But this is functionally what overventilation is. It is high tidal volume and or high airway pressures. And of course, those are often associated, but it's either of those. That's overventilation. It's too much air, or air too fast, or squeezing for too long, right? It's pressures. It's volumes that are too big. Hyperventilation. And again, technically there's some crossover, but hyperventilation is too fast. This is different. This is overventilation, and you're going to see it's a real eye-opener how important this is. Okay, so it's been shown over and over again. I've made it really clear that basically what we do in the EMS and in the ED for resuscitation when we're doing manual ventilation is the absolute antithesis of lung protective ventilation. That'll certainly be meaningful to the critical care nurses, to some of the physicians, and to all the respiratory therapists. And we'll come back to the definition in a minute. But let me just point something out here. Let me do the FDA-approved kill switch here. Literally kill switch. Whoever made the big bag should be executed because they have killed so many patients. You know what this is? 1,800 cc's. This baby is 1,800 cc's. Aren't you glad when you get that tube in, you can really use that tube? Okay, so here is what has happened in Arizona. We're going to come back. We'll have a stretch break in a few minutes, and we'll come back, and we're actually going to work with the flow-controlled bag and more details on it. But what I just want to point out, the single thing I want to point out for the moment now is, this, in the EPIC study in Arizona, this, two fingers, these two go away, those two go away, this, and one finger on this, and only for the second, the 1 second, I love this manufacturer because this doesn't just flash every 6 seconds, 10 per minute, but it actually stays for a second, so you're only supposed to squeeze gently for as long as the light goes. So let me show you what a proper ventilation is with a human hand. Okay, you ready? Now, by the way, all of a sudden, some of you are already saying, wait a second, somebody timed this. That delay, the manufacturer had to screw up. That can't possibly be every 6 seconds. Let me tell you, tongue in cheek, this is how we taught how to not hyperventilate in EMS. If you've gotten into the ambulance and you're transporting to the trauma center, and if you don't have them on a ventilator yet, then here's what you do. You gently give the squeeze when the light goes on. If you don't have the light, gently give the squeeze and then ask the driver to stop the ambulance. You walk slowly around the ambulance. And then when you get back in and start the transport again, it's almost time to give the next. It's really hard to do it this slowly when our epi level is higher than the patient's. Okay? In fact, it's impossible. I'll show you in a minute as we talk about IVI. But in any case, this is a proper ventilation with a manual bag. Two fingers, and when the light goes on, and as soon as the light goes off, it goes away. You ready for this? Two-thirds of a can of soda. Two-thirds of, you know what? Do you know how many cans of soda you can put in here? Like 12, okay? It's ridiculous. So who has ever thought of using a bag like that? In fact, don't embarrass me if this isn't true in your experience, but I go into the ICU now at the University of Arizona. Who was here when we were all taught you give 10 cc's per kilo or even 12? Because, man, we want to keep those alveoli open, right? 10 or 12 cc's per kilo is the tidal volume. Anybody besides me? There got to be some. That was it. You put the tube in and you give 10 to 12 cc's per kilo. And 12 may even be better because, again, we don't want any of those bazillions of alveoli. We don't want one of them closed. More on PEEP later, okay, for EMS at least. But think about this. Now today at the University of Arizona, we use in 95% of the patients. There are, of course, exceptions in specific conditions, but 5 cc's per kilo. Do you know when you walk through the ICU at the University of Arizona, if the patient's comatose, they look dead. Because the average adult, you cannot see the chest move. That's how gentle a lung protective, and I think about my whole career. Now, let me show you my career. I've been an attending physician for 32 years at the busiest trauma center between LA and Dallas. We do, ready for this? We do 10 trauma RSI intubations per 24 hours. Every 2.5 hours, we're putting somebody down and intubating them for trauma in our setting. That's how busy we are. And it's so busy that the early day arguments between the trauma surgeons and emergency medicine are long gone. We alternate back and forth. The trauma surgeon are almost now, can't you guys just run them? If they need to go to the OR, I'm so stinking tired, just call me. You guys run them. So we alternate back and forth. So I have run hundreds of intubated resuscitations in my career. And until about a decade ago, you know how I ran the resuscitation? If I was the one running it and I did the tube, sometimes often the residents do, but if I did the tube, I've now gotten the tube in, and you know what? I'm not going to let anybody touch that tube because I don't want anybody to mess with my tube because it's my tube. And, you know, everybody's saying, oh, you're amazing, right? By the way, paramedics, do not look smug. I know this is exactly like you too. Okay, so here you are, you're right, and this is how I'm running the resuscitation. Okay, now next, we need to get, anybody ever else done this, or am I the only one on the planet that has killed my patients, okay? Or at least their brains. Isn't this right? You're doing that and you're doing that. Why? Because, one, I thought the tube was like doing God's work. Two, it's amazing, and by the way, we cheat in emergency medicine because the paramedics, you don't get to charge for the tube. We do. Okay, so there's even another conflict of interest for putting that stinking tube in, right? And focusing on the procedure. The hospital gets to charge for ventilation. I don't get to charge for ventilation. Who cares about ventilation? So that's the whole career of all of us who are junkies for getting a tube in. And here we are, we're running the thing and we're doing this. And you know what? What we have done is we are stretching the alveoli. We'll come back to this in a minute. And we are setting all those patients up for for acute respiratory distress syndrome. Again, more data on that in just a minute. But the reality is, those days have to be completely over. We're going to deal with how in the world do you do that in our kind of setting in just a minute. But okay, so that's the big bag thing. So here's the key: unless meticulously guarded against, emergency manual ventilation is reliably, and this is by any hands. I don't care whether you're an anesthesiologist, a respiratory therapist, an RN, an MD, a paramedic, a basic EMT, in human hands during the fray of resuscitation, unless it's meticulously guarded against, every one of us give too forceful and too deep of a manual ventilation. Every last one of us, because of distraction. And here now is why there's been massive changes to lung protective volumes in ventilation. Forget the details. This is growth-related oncogene, and what that means is it tells you how much inflammation is going on in the alveoli. So this is rats. They do the study, and then they actually get lavage. They get the fluid out of the lungs, and they test how much inflammatory fluid is in it. Okay. And interestingly enough, they were trying to see, because some of you have been around long enough to hear ARDS called shock lung. We actually thought it was the shock that was creating the infusion. Let me give a quick for the EMTs and some of the paramedics that don't know about it. Acute respiratory distress syndrome is where there's a breakdown in the covering of the alveoli, the little tiny air sacs. The lining breaks down and fluid goes into the alveolus. So functionally, the patient drowns in their own fluid, okay? So amazingly enough, the thought used to be, well, if you go into shock, that causes the ARDS. Brilliant study done here. Notice, this is the controls. This is the amount of inflammatory fluid, okay, the setup for getting ARDS. And look at this. This is the ones that rats that were in prolonged, profound hemorrhagic shock. It is not statistically different. There is no more inflammation in hemorrhagic shock than in normal animals. None. This is simply putting them on mechanical ventilation, and you're ready for what it is? The equivalent in humans of 10 cc's per kilo. So for most of my career, we were literally setting patients up to get ARDS, and I'll show you the mortality statistics of what happens when you get ARDS, independent of what, regardless of what condition you're in. And notice, the way to do it worse is to have shock and what used to be normal. Okay, and here's the key. If you are not doing flow-controlled bag and you're manually ventilating, you're doing way worse than 10 per kilo. This is just 10 per kilo tidal volume. Our volumes sometimes are ridiculous, right? We're doing three Coke cans worth of air, and we should be doing two-thirds of one Coke can, okay? This stuff, again, I know, when I finally put this together, I really felt badly. Because it was like, you know what, we've known a lot of this stuff for a long time, but nobody ever put it together. Okay, so look at this. If you get ARDS, there's a large literature in all of these conditions. Any of you ever taken care of or intubated anybody like this? In every one of these, the adjusted likelihood that the patient will die, independent of anything else, is if they get ARDS, it doubles the likelihood they will die. 10 per kilo is all it takes, let alone what we do. Okay, and now it's even worse. As of 2010, this brilliant study, a meta-analysis, meta-analysis is just a fancy word for taking a bunch of smaller studies and putting them together so it's the equivalent of a really large study. And there's ways to do that so that you know that it's not a scam. Really well done in JAMA. And notice this, almost 3,000 patients, and they did a meta-analysis of patients that were using lung protective volumes, meaning five or six cc's per kilo, and everybody who was above that, seven or more. So it was basically 7 to 10, okay? So pretty subtle difference. The difference in 5 or 6 per kilo versus 7 through 10 per kilo, okay? And then they excluded all the patients who got ARDS. So now we're talking about regular non-ARDS patients. So we're talking about all the rest of your patients, everybody who didn't get ARDS. We already know we double their risk of death if they get ARDS. But look at this. In patients who don't get ARDS, look what happens to their adjusted likelihood of surviving if they get lung protective ventilation. They are 36% more likely to survive if they get lung protective ventilation. Without ARDS, they are two-thirds more likely to survive, not get lung injury. They're more than half as likely to get, let me make sure I'm saying this right. The lung protective group gets pneumonia less than half as often as the non-lung protective, and they spend 2 days shorter in the hospital. They actually spend 2.5 days shorter in the ICU non-ARDS patients. So remember when I started with that really provocative slide with a really huge A and a little tiny B? And then I said it should be a little tiny A and a really big B? It should be a little tiny A and a really big B. Everywhere you look at it, the reversal of sucking air in versus us pushing air in for them, in every single situation, all of the body systems, it's bad. Okay, so right before we're getting really close to a stretch break. Okay, here are the axioms, okay, of manual ventilation in emergency settings. You ready? Axiom number one, no one, I told you I'd make everybody mad, not even RTs, no one can properly ventilate manually in the emergency setting. No one can properly ventilate without ventilation adjuncts. We'll go through them in the lab part. Axiom number two, no one can properly ventilate manually without ventilation adjuncts. Axiom three, did I mention that no one can properly ventilate? So, okay, you get the point? No one on the planet is able to do this, and here is why. Because every one of you in this room are emergency care providers, because emergency care in this setting means everybody until they get to the operating room or the ICU on a ventilator, right? That's the resuscitation. You're taking them to the CT, right? You're doing all this kind of stuff. All of that period of time, there's a very high likelihood that they will get manual ventilation for significant periods of time, okay? So 100% of emergency care providers have this specific, well-documented, and we are the ones that documented it, neuropsychiatric disorder. You all have this psychiatric disorder. You ready? And so do I, because I'm an emergency care provider. It's called inadvertent ventilatory inattentiveness. Okay, let that soak in for a minute. It's inadvertent. Like I said, it's second degree. It's not first degree murder. It's inadvertent. And we all are inattentive to doing this. All of us. Because the place is crazy. And you add on top of it, we're congratulating ourselves for the A. Okay, so notice, why do we all have IVI? Because we're too busy saving the patient's life and too proud of getting the tube in to pay any attention to something as trivial as the B. We're distracted. So here's the syndrome. During emergency manual ventilation without meticulous prevention, everyone hyperventilates and overventilates. We all go too fast, and we all push too hard and too long. Every last one of us. And the studies, I already mentioned this, some of the studies show the mean rate, forget the overventilation for a minute, is as high in some systems as 40 a minute. Okay, so why do we have IVI? Because distraction is inevitable. Because ventilation is remarkably gentle. I've already showed you. Do you know, what's a crack up to me is, back in the day when I was training, the ventilator took up half the room in the resuscitation suite, right? They were gigantic. And do you know what that gigantic thing did? It did that. That gigantic thing is really, really gentle. The human hand that's with a distracted mind is never gentle with it. So, as I said before, our adrenaline level is higher than the patient's. And here's the other thing. Proper ventilation just doesn't feel right. If I'm not moving their chest, the tube couldn't possibly be doing what it's supposed to. So, man, I'm going to move that chest, aren't you? I want to move that chest. Here's the beauty. Does everybody here in your practice setting have end-tidal CO2? Okay, yeah, I'm seeing like nods essentially everywhere. Okay, here's the key. You do not need to see the chest rise. In fact, if you're doing lung protective ventilation, you won't see the chest rise in the, okay, if you've intubated a 9-year-old boy with 5% body fat, you'll see the chest rise probably. But the reality is, the beauty is you don't have to see the chest rise because you get to see every single exhalation that shows you that the tube is still in the right place. You don't have to see the chest going up and down to know that the tube is in the right place. In fact, what's one of the classic ways to know the tube is in the right place? Chest rise. Do you know what we were doing when we were checking for the tube? We were overventilating to make sure the chest rose. Isn't it amazing? We have built this all wrong. It's all backwards. Okay, so, by the way, Lars Wick, who's from Norway, world-famous resuscitologist, he's an anesthesiologist, and he was at one of the times I was giving this talk, and he said, Dan, this is, of course anesthesiologists do this. We were born to ventilate. If we get that tube in, we're going to use that. Bag. So it's just kind of how we are. So here's the cure. Meticulous, multifaceted, active adjuncts to help prevent hyper and overventilation when you are manually ventilating, and to get you to markedly shorten the time that you manually ventilate and get patients to a ventilator. Let me just ask this question before we take a quick break and then come back and do some hands-on stuff. How many here have ventilators in the setting where you do emergency care? Raise your hands high. Okay, look around. Okay, so good. Almost all, and maybe all the EMS providers here, you have ventilators. And we'll come back to this in a moment, but I just, at the break, I want to tell you this. Many people have said, I don't need all these things because we put them right on the ventilator. No, you don't. You don't put them right on the ventilator. And the reason why is, do you know how long it takes for the nerve cell to start dying when it has inadequate blood flow? And remember, you drop a little bit below, you dropped a 32 on that CO2, and you already have markedly compromised blood flow to the brain. Do you know how long it takes for the neuron to start dying with inadequate blood flow? 4 minutes. When's the last time you went from the first breath after intubation to getting the patient on your ventilator? Probably never. So this is really important. Coming back to how we prevent ourselves from using this as a murder weapon in a minute. Okay, I have 13 after. I will restart at 18 after because I want to give you some time to ask some questions at the end. 5 minutes. See you back. Okay, here we go. Now, as you're making your way back, make sure that there's at least one of these at every table, because now I'm going to make you feel worse. I feel so badly and have for the last decade about what all I did. I'm certainly going to make you feel bad too. Okay, so put the FDA kill switch. Let me tell you what I mean by that. In Europe, you can get flow-controlled bags, and it doesn't have this switch. Do you know why the FDA, now that you have this physiological background, you ready for the FDA's reasoning for having a WIMP valve so that you can turn it back into this? You know what it was? Well, what if you need to give them more pressure than you need to when the piston is? What if you need to give them more pressure? And I'm thinking is, let me get this straight. What if I need to give 5 times more than the maximum I should give them in pressure? Why do I need to be able to give 10 times more than the maximum pressure that I should be giving them? That's what happens when you turn it back into this, okay? You're talking massive, massive pressures and stretch to the and damage to the alveolus, okay? So everybody turn the WIMP valve the right way, and if you start using this, don't ever turn it back the other way, okay? Now, listen to this, and then I want you to all do it at your table. Listen to this. Everybody hear the piston? Now get this and pass it around the table and see how little it takes to engage that piston. Because you're supposed to be ventilating with the piston not engaging. Do you realize how little it takes to give too much flow and too much pressure? Okay, now, again, take a few minutes here, pass it around. If you're doing a peds bag, look at your light. I don't know if everybody has light, but if you're doing a peds bag, do one, okay, one finger, one thumb, and just do it for that second and then let go. You're not going to believe it. You're going to think you're killing the patient when you're doing it right. Okay, and if you got the adult bag, and then after everybody has felt, oh my goodness, I can't, that was my whole, there would not have been one patient before I learned this stuff, there would not have been one patient in my entire career that I didn't give more pressure than that. Not one in my entire career. Okay, so just get used to that and letting go. It's just amazing. So I'm going to go on because I want to leave time for you to ask some questions. But okay, so here's the cure, right? Here's the cure. I already hammered you on that enough. I'm going to move on. Meticulous, multifaceted, active adjuncts to help prevent hyper and overventilation. And this is really important. Unless you are an anesthesiologist who has one of those really soft little things, and my description of the specialty of anesthesiology is months of boredom with a few intermittent moments of terror. That's anesthesiology to me, okay? There was no way. I would go nuts. I just don't like panpipe music as much as they do. So notice, you've got the... So if you're an anesthesiologist who you in your sleep, you dream waveforms, right? Entitled to CO2 waveforms. Yes. Can you sit there and just, you know, so because, you know, you're tired of just watching the vent, right, and reading the paper. Can you sit there and do this every once in a while and watch and keep it at 40? Yes. Do you realize how far away that is from our universe? All right, so unless you are that setting, everyone else, including specialists at ventilation that are in the fray of the ED or the resuscitation suite, or moving them to a CT scanner, taking them from the ICU, taking them off the vent and moving them, every single ventilation should be done with a rate timer, a piston that tells you to stop pushing so hard, and with, as we'll see in a minute, a single person whose sole purpose is to make sure that you are just as soft as a ventilator. Okay? Does that describe any resuscitation you have ever watched in your career? Never. So we have to force that, and that's what we've done with Epic in the state of Arizona, and we're hoping it's going to show that it made dramatic difference in the outcome for TBI patients by doing that in EMS. Okay, so by the way, I'm in the state of Arizona. This is important enough in Arizona. We just approved end-tidal seal monitoring as a BLS skill in the state of Arizona, even though it's not in the national training or the national skills. And you'll see in a minute why. We specifically want it to be the EMT. The EMTs, basic EMTs, you're going to love this. Get ready to elbow the paramedic next to you. You're going to love this, okay? But first, enough about that we understand this. Okay, so this is, end-tidal CO2 monitoring reads backwards, because it seems like, you know, when it goes up, that should be when they're inspiring, right? And when it goes down, that should be when they're inhaling. It's not. So let me just explain it. The ET tube is in, and there's a sensor that picks up on CO2, right? Right near the entrance to the tube, okay? And in the air, in the ambient air, there's essentially zero CO2. It's so tiny and minuscule, it reads as zero, okay, to the sensor. So what happens is, let's start with an inspiration because it makes a lot of sense. You start pushing air or oxygen from the atmosphere or from an oxygen tank, you start putting that in, and the CO2 level that the sensor sees drops precipitously to zero, right? Because you're pushing no CO2 through. You're pushing through either 100% oxygen or air, and or some combination, and air has functionally zero CO2, okay? So it very quickly drops to zero. And this is a proper ventilation here, okay? So notice, for 1 second, and only 1 second, it stays at zero because that was a proper ventilation that lasted 1 second. And then what happens is as soon as you let the pressure off, the patient starts to exhale. And notice what happens to the CO2 level. The CO2, which is in us right now, the concentration of CO2 in our alveoli, in our lungs, is 40 millimeters of mercury, okay? That's what's in our lungs. So as soon as you start exhaling past that sensor, very quickly it goes up, and then we won't talk about any other waveforms because it's not necessary for us to understand how to do this. And then for the rest of the 5 seconds, you know, that interminably long 5 seconds for expiration that the patient really needs, okay? It slowly drifts up, and then the reason why you have heard the term end tidal CO2 is a tidal cycle in classic respiratory sciences is from the beginning of inspiration through inspiration, through exhalation, all the way until the next inspiration starts. So it's the end of the tidal cycle, okay? So end tidal CO2, in this case, is exactly what it should be, 40. Okay, that's the target. Okay, and this doesn't matter what your patient is, that's your target. We'll ignore COPD for the moment, because it's almost inconsequential to what we're talking about today. So notice this. All right, so notice this. Even if the ventilation is really nice and soft and is the right tidal volume, let's say it's lung protective, it's just two fingers and it's just a little bit. But if you go, in this case, almost three times as fast, notice the pressures may be okay, although that fast, you're going to actually stack some pressures. So the pressure is going to go higher than it should. But notice when you're doing that, what you have done is, and what's different in addition to the rate, what's different about these waveforms? They only get up to 30. Remember what happens to sick patients when they only get up to 30? We kill their brain cells, okay? This is a disaster, no matter what sick patient you're taking care of. Okay, bad. All right, I showed this in the extreme. This is where the expiration was basically a second, and then we went like all 5 seconds, okay? Now tell me that this wasn't too big of a ventilation. Okay, I showed it in the extreme, but you know what is typical in this setting? Remember, I'm running the trauma resuscitation. Typical is about half the time I'm inspiring and about half the time I'm expiring, right? It's about half and half. When I'm half and half like that, I am way stretching the alveoli, I'm way stacking, and I almost for sure have given way too much volume. It's just too long to push the thing for me to spend that much time. So too long is bad, and notice, of course, when you're doing too long, it's gonna be, it may be way lower than 30. And then here is, notice this. You see this waveform? And see the waveform up here? They're identical except for one thing. What's different about this waveform and that waveform? Just the end tidal CO2. So what does this, since the waveform is identical, what does this tell you about the tidal volume, the amount that's being given up here, and the amount that's being given during this second? They're both just inspiring for 1 second. They're doing the right amount of time. What does 30 mean is happening during this 1 second of inspiration? Too much. Everything else was right. You were following the timer, but the problem is you might have been using your whole hand. Okay, so notice you can have everything perfect, but if you give too much with every inspiration, you get killer CO2. Okay? So has anybody yet stumbled into the fact how far away we have been from this kind of care with this thing? It's really quite striking, isn't it? It's like we are so far away from the way it should be. Okay, so here is the way the adjuncts for preventing hyperventilation should work. Adults, I'm using the TBI rates of ventilation, and actually they work essentially for almost all sick patients. the asterisks aren't even worth talking about right now. Adults, meaning age 15 and above in the TBI guidelines, it's a good cutoff, are 10 per minute. And peds are meaning 14 or lower, are 20 a minute. And the nice thing about this manufacturer, not only is you get 1 second so you know how briefly to push, but the purple ones, notice the purple ones, that's the peds, that's 20 a minute. So, if you guys start using them and you get both, the beauty is, otherwise those two would look really similar. So the purple is peds. And for the melancholy personalities, if you got to know what the neonates are, they're 25. Okay, you know what's ironic though? In most systems taking care of traumatic brain injury today who intubate, it would be a blessing and save people if in the adults they would slow down to the neonatal rate of 25. I mean, how embarrassing is that? We've been, 10 a minute is just unbelievably slow. Okay, so notice very specifically, until on a ventilator, use the ventilation rate timer. Until on a ventilator, every breath, you need to have the piston pushing back. Every single setting, ICU to CT scanner, manually ventilated, everybody needs this, no matter how much ventilation you do. No matter how, even if it's your profession, to ventilate. Okay. Continuous end-tidal CO2 monitoring, okay? Again, you know now the ranges in the target really well. And this is what we added in Epic because we knew just the widgets wouldn't cut it. The VEMT, or the ventilator EMT, you'll see in a minute, it's a double entendre. And this is what, this is it. It's the most important person on the team. You now know why. Because the B should be gigantic and the A should be little. Here's now the time where you should gloat if you're a basic EMT. Let me tell you what your role is in EMS. It is to keep the paramedic from killing the patient with their advanced skills. Everybody got that? Yeah, I mean, the EMTs are gonna go home feeling really good tonight. Paramedics, not so much. Okay, so this is true. If you're the intubator, somebody else needs to take over who cares about the bee and does nothing but the bee and never gets distracted. So think of this. They are protected from distraction. They're the most important person on the team. They only have one job. Here's their job. Constant vigilance on gentle, controlled, slow, small breaths, carefully following the ventilation rate timer and preventing any piston engagement, not one time, if we do it right. Constant attention to end-tidal CO2, bothering everyone until the patient is on a vent. This person, the whole time, is supposed to be saying, why haven't you put them on the vent? Where's my vent? Why haven't, okay, in the resuscitation suite at the trauma center at the university, you know what we had to actually treat? Anesthesia doesn't come. We do all the airways, emergency medicine does. But we actually have dedicated RTs. We're so busy. And you know what we had to start doing with the RTs? We had to actually train them. No, you don't bag the patient up. No, you don't have to feel the lungs, because if you're feeling the lungs, you're pushing way too hard. So interestingly enough, you ready for this in our setting? Because remember, you no longer have any question if the tube is in the right place. With the very first exhalation, you know the tube is in the right place or not in the right place. You ready for this? There are tubes that go in and the RT connects the ventilator for the first ventilation. That's the kind of meticulousness that it takes. So this person should be driving that. Okay, so in EMS and in the ED, until the patient's on a vent, every breath should be administered with ventilatory adjuncts by totally committed team member, with every breath being observed. You ready for this? About a year into the training with Epic, you know what we realized? The VEMT gets distracted. So in the state of Arizona, and I think, tell me, in any of your systems, do you only big crash, you know, bad injuries, do any of you only have one or two providers at the scene within, you know, or do all of you have more than two providers within 10 minutes, say, of the crash? Is that true here? Because in Arizona, 95% of the cases have five EMS providers on average there within 7 minutes of the 911 call, okay? So, you know what that means when there's, and two of them are intubators, right? Two paramedics, three basic EMTs, typical. So what we now have done is we've added the watcher. And the watcher's role is this. They watch and wait for the VEMT to get distracted, and then they take a plastic baseball bat and hit him in the side of the head and say, you're supposed to be doing ventilation. Don't care about the stupid IV, okay? So we actually, think of this. This is how hard it is to do. Two dedicated people on the pit crew to make sure that every single manual ventilation is done correctly. That's how hard it is to do this. I already told you, if you think you put them on the vent, no, you don't. Brain cells start dying way too fast. So you have to have the ventilation adjuncts and at least one, if you can, two people to make sure you do it right. Let me do a couple of cases and then we'll, this is really fun, and that's why I took the time to talk about end-tidal CO2 so the basic EMTs will understand this too. So big crash, bad head injury, GCS3, blood pressure a little on the high side, everything got done right, pulse ox is 100, long distance from the trauma center, so they decided to intubate. And let me orient all of us for this now. So this is no longer the waveforms. Notice, each one of these dots is now an end-tidal CO2, and this is the end-tidal CO2 tracing over time. Okay, you got that? So here's where the tube went in and the sensor went on, and here's minute. So there's a minute 11, minute 12, minute 13. So this is like 6 minutes here, okay? You got that? And notice I clipped this off at 30, and 35 to 45 is the green zone for end-tidal CO2, okay? Because we're going to see a series of these now, so everybody is tracking with what the case looks like. And this is the ventilation rate, okay? So notice, same time on the x-axis. And then notice, this is 7 to, so the target is 10 per minute, because this is traumatic brain injury. And by the way, I would use the same if I were you for cardiac arrest and other sick patients as well. And so this is 7 to 12 is the green zone here. And one thing that most of us don't realize is, what does it tell you that the very first breath, the very first exhalation after the tube went in, started with a CO2 of 33. What does that mean? What that means is, with the bag and bag valve mask, you can hyper and overventilate a patient. Everybody got this? You know what? We expected when we started, we have now hundreds of these out of the thousands of cases. We now have hundreds of these that the EMS providers are providing directly to us at the university. You know what we expected? We expected, oh my goodness, a lot of these are RSI. They've been apneic, right? We expected to have really high CO2s and have to bag them down. We never see high. We always see low. It always starts low. You ready for this? We're already bagging them too much and too often with bag valve mask, even before we get the tube in. It just makes it much easier to do it badly when we get the tube in. So, amazing, isn't it? So notice, this is a great team who paid attention. They immediately realized, look at this, they're only bagging at what, 13, 14 a minute? But what they realized very quickly was, uh-oh, too fast, and look how quickly, within here, about 45 seconds, they have dramatically decreased. In fact, look at this one. They were smart enough to realize we've slowed down some and we're still under 35. You know what they did? You ready for what this patient needed? This patient needed 20 seconds of apnea. Okay? 100% oxygenation. They're not going to get hypoxemic in 20 seconds. Do you know what the best treatment for this patient was? No ventilation for 20 seconds. And look what happened. Then you get the nice bump. And now that they've really slowed it down, they now stay in this range. Take-home message, do you realize how hard it is to do this? It's really hard. Look how hard they had to work to stay in here. Now, I'm not asking this to the RTs because you guys are professionals of this and know way more than me. And please don't, thank you for not embarrassing me so far tonight. You've cheated. This is your whole life. Anybody else, the doctors have kind of cheated too. And if you're an ICU nurse, you've cheated too. You know too much of this. Anybody else want to tell me why, when you've now slowed down to, eight, seven, why you're still barely in the 35, 36, 37 range with entitled CO2? What does that mean about the volume of these ventilations? Too big. Everybody got this? This is really important. Notice, if you go too long, you can even sneak around and never engage the piston, but you can give too much. Okay? So, you know what's really cool? If we pay attention to this, we have the tools to do this really well and to understand the nuances of exactly what we're doing. And go back and say, we sent this as an attaboy to the fire chief and said, go back and show your team how brilliant it was that they did a 20-second pause of apnea to get this patient's end-tidal CO2 right. I mean, this is really, and remember, this stuff dwarfs the impact of the neurosurgeon. This stuff really matters. Okay, so case conclusion. Even when paying close attention, it's really hard to do proper manual ventilation. 26-year-old male, fell from a scaffold at work, big TBI, GCS3, blood pressure's fine, everything's gone right, decided to intubate, 100% pulse ox, okay? So I've entitled this slide, Good Start. Everybody see it? It was a good start, wasn't it? Now remember, by the way, what does this entitled CO2 in here tell you? What, 25, 30? What does it tell you about what they were doing with the bag valve mask? Too fast and too deep, almost for sure both, okay? But in any case, what's interesting is, and they started really fast, what, 25? But despite being at 25, they actually got it up into the 36 range here for a little while, right? So they were going this fast. What does this tell you about their tidal volume when their tidal volume was, what does it tell about the tidal volume that they still got it up into the green zone with the CO2? Going this fast, what did it mean about their tidal volume? They were really being very gentle, right? Because they're going 25 times a minute and they still corrected into the green zone, okay? So, but notice what happened. Almost immediately they drop below here, and look what happens to the rate of their ventilations. You know, here they are, congratulating themselves for getting the tube in. And notice the amount of time. 20 minutes, and notice where this ends up. At 25, this patient has a 100% chance of having a dead brain. Neurosurgeon may have taken the clot out. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. So, we send this one back too. We at the university, we never know individual level because it's up to the agencies to do their QI, but we give them these tools. Let me point this out to you. How many times would I have done that in my career? Over and over and over. How often did I know it? Never. Do you think this crew knew this? Of course not. In fact, what's interesting is we've given this, I think it's on the next one. But the key is, in your system, wherever you are, you need to be able to QI every single one of your cases with this kind of information. So I told him this morning, whether you have new monitors, old monitors, you need tomorrow to call your manufacturer and say, we're getting new monitors and we're not sure it's going to be you. But here's how it can be you. We need this. We need to be able to get the waveform data on every single patient that we want. It needs to be easy. It needs to be automatic. We don't need to have some person who has to drive around to the stations to get the chips and all that kind of stuff. You need to figure out a wireless way to give us this every time so the medic can see it, the EMT can see it, and tell the medic, see, I saved the patient's life, not you, right? You need all of this, and it goes to the QI team, and it goes to the medical director. Is Scott here? Yeah, I spoke for you this morning. They told me there's only 2 intubations per 24 hours on average in the system. So I said, you have more than enough time to look at every case. So I do that myself with 12 fire departments. You're welcome. Notice, if we don't have this information, we will never know that we're killing patients. if we don't have this information. So, you know what's interesting? The manufacturers are not to be blamed. Nobody has ever asked for this. We should be embarrassed. So, we have to figure out a way. This is the sermon part of the evening, right before the Q&A. So distracted. This is why we recommended, I don't know if it was this case, but it was a case like this, where we finally realized one person watching the manual ventilation is not enough. We need two. We need a watcher. Okay. This is well named, isn't it? Glad I finally looked. And I picked this one because it could not have been more poignant. How many minutes was this patient at 25? Everybody see that? Why couldn't we have looked at 30 seconds? This was long enough to start apoptosis of all of this patient's brain cells. Okay? So, now what's really good and what's great about this, and we did congratulate them, because notice, somebody, maybe the plastic bat worked, right? Look at this. Somebody said, holy cow, we're killing, in Arizona, they would have said, oh my goodness, we're killing brain cells, because they know this stuff. And you can tell how dramatic they were, and this is amazing. Look at how long they paused in between ventilations to get this up here. And you know what's really cool? Is if you've been doing it wrong, if somebody pays attention, look how quickly you can make it normal. You know what the bad news is? You know how many breaths it takes to take it back down? 4 or 5. Every single breath has to be watched meticulously. This is a way better case than this, right? But this and this should have happened right here, right? So the team learned a lot from this. I have to show you this one, and then we're almost ready. Actually, then I'll tell you the Dan Davis story, and then we'll do Q&A. This is a classic case of inadvertent ventilatory inattentiveness. This is in a post-epic trained setting in a really good fire-based EMS system, really good. They have incredibly good cardiac arrest outcomes. They've paid a lot of attention. They have real-time audiovisual feedback for CPR, right, so that they know depth. They know release velocity, all that kind of stuff. In the system where this happened, you ready for this? Witnessed VF now has a successful going home, neurologically intact, of 6 out of 10 patients. Not bad, okay? This is a really good EMS system. But there's 35, there's 25. The highest was 25, and look how long this happened for. For 20 minutes, we guaranteed that this patient will never wake up, ever. And look at this, okay? We've given this a term because we've tried, every time we've discovered this kind of stuff, the great news in Arizona is we never divulge who did this, what agency, we never embarrass anybody, they've learned that they can trust us. And we send them the good news and the bad news, and then they do internally what they want to within their QI system with that. But we've given this a handle, we've given it a term. You know what this is called? By the way, this unit had a $32,000 in-title CO2 monitor. $32,000 stinking dollars, right? And you know what they used the in-title CO2 monitor for? They used it to verify that the tube was right in the right place and then to document that they killed the patient. But it was inadvertent. They didn't mean to, okay? Here's the key. You know what? We have to mean not to. It's not okay anymore that we didn't mean to. We have to mean not to, okay? And we've actually, here's the handle. You ready for this? We have called this in-title CO2 monitoring that isn't. Do you do in-title CO2 monitoring that isn't? You all have in-title CO2. And so what I would say is, my whole career I did in-title CO2 monitoring that wasn't, okay? So don't do in-title CO2 monitoring that isn't. So here's the plea to, in here, if you're a medical director involved in QI, a supervisor, a manager, raise your hand. Okay, probably, maybe 20 of you are involved in the, right? Medical directors, managers, educators, QI teams. Here's the key about entitled CO2 monitoring. I meant to overdo the number of tracings, okay? Use it, check it, QI it, report it, ask about it, demand to see it. Demand from the manufacturer that you've got to see it. There's no more of not having this, because we don't know whether we saved the patient or not, because we don't have it to look back at. So don't let entitled CO2 monitoring be a tool that simply documents that you're killing patients. Let me just tell the Dan Davis story and show you how impressively different this can be. Okay, so remember the San Diego RSI trial? It was stopped at the interim analysis, the first interim analysis, because of harm, right? It was dangerous. Data Safety Monitoring Board said, wow, the intubated arm is doing so much worse, we can't even continue the study for ethical reasons. Okay, that's the San Diego RSI trial. You know, sad, bad news. There are other studies like, you know, Stephen Bernard's that have subsequently showed much better. I'll talk about why in a minute, from Melbourne, Australia, since then. But the San Diego RSI trial seemed to show that intubating cases in the field was really bad. There was one subcohort that did much better if they were intubated. So Dan Davis, who's a really close, long-term colleague of mine, good friend, Dan Davis sent a paper. I'm the associate editor for the EMS section for Annals of Emergency Medicine. He sent a paper in, and functionally the title went something like this: helicopters save lives in traumatic brain injury. I mean, it wasn't like New York Times would do, but it was something more, actually much more sophisticated. It was something like the impact of air medical care on major traumatic injury patients. And what it said was, holy cow, look at this. All the ground patients did worse, but the air patients did amazingly better. So there must be something really special about air medical transport. I read the abstract, and I emailed Dan and said, Dan, I'm sending your paper back. You need to rewrite it, and the reason why is because he and I were both air medical directors, and I knew what he was doing. I'll show you in a minute what he was doing. And what Dan Davis had done was, he had set up ultimately a system, because he was the air medical director, where after every single ventilated patient, when they finished their electronic documentation, an auto email went with the documentation and the entire waveform series to Dan. And Dan checked it eight times a day. It's funny to hear the flight nurses and flight paramedics talk about the days when they used to get emails at 2:30 in the morning with Dan saying, did you realize that you got an entitled CO2 down to 33 in this patient? So guess what happened? There stopped being entitled CO2s of 33 in the air medical transported patients in San Diego County. And so what happened was, there was an entire cohort of the study where if they intubated and did the B right, remember how the B is supposed to be so important? They did the A and the B right, the patients did much better. So it wasn't the helicopter, and it wasn't the air medical environment. It was that somebody was doing something that if you do it right, your improvement in survival may be 600% improved. That's what it was. So all of us can do this, but let me just show you this, how important, if you set your system up right, it's amazing how many patients you can save. So these are all of the air medical arrivals from 1992 through 2002, okay, and now you're all experts at this, right? Here's 35, this is actually arrival CO2. Forget that there's a slight difference between entitled and actual CO2. Irrelevant at this point. So 35 to 44, right? This is normal. And what this is the mean in each year for air medical transported, intubated, traumatic brain injury patients, okay? Each year, this is the air medical transported, intubated, traumatic brain injury patients. And this is the average CO2 of the first blood gas at the trauma center. So this is the arrival CO2 after their pre-hospital care. This is before Dan Davis came along. 1996 actually, Dan Davis became the medical director, and he said, he actually talked to manufacturers, and nobody was, except in, you know, in literally in pig labs and rat labs, was anybody using in the field entitled CO2 at that time. He got the manufacturer to give them a bunch of boxes. They were actually pretty gigantic, and all they did was read entitled CO2. But he said, yeah, give them to me. So notice what they did. 1997, for the first time ever, they actually arrived on average at 35. This was when they got the entitled CO2 monitors, and it got way better the next year. And then guess what happened? Let's see, this was too early to be Ebola. Do you realize how distractible we are? They got a new widget. Yeah, I wonder what it was. I don't remember 1999, but do you know how much money the federal government spent on Ebola? $2 billion. Do you know how many patients were transported by EMS in America from Ebola? Two patients. $2 billion should have been on entitled CO2 monitors. Notice, something got distracted. So Dan said, holy cow, I'm putting my foot down. And that is where he engaged. Not only did they have entitled CO2 monitors, but they ended up with the automatic email to the QI supervisor and Dan Davis in real time, and they started looking at every case. And look at this. So I basically leave you with the question, you're going to do something about this. In my systems, I'm the medical director for 12 fire departments. This has become the big deal. Do you realize the beauty of, I think I said this yesterday morning, they love, oops, I did what a smart PhD student does, use the entire time to present your data so that the faculty can't ask any hard questions at the end. The beautiful thing has been, they used to do 100% QI. Do you realize what a waste of time it is to do QI on 40% of the patients who are sick persons? I can tell you what happens. They get all kinds of different care, and they all survive. Okay, QA done on 40%, right? This is one of the very few things that get QI'd. The other thing is, we have real-time audiovisual feedback for chest compressions, and we get every one of those cases. That's the two things, because if our system is meticulous enough about these two things to care that much, I can assume that they're taking great care of patients who have hypoglycemia. I think we do have 3 minutes.
Can you quickly go through the hypotensive episode?
Yes. You know what? I think I took that out of this one. Although that is a good slide, isn't it? No. Here we go. Boy, that's a new PowerPoint. By the way, this is the answer to PEEP in the EMS setting. Why do you give PEEP? In the ICU, why do you give PEEP? Because it lowers the amount of tidal volume, et cetera, that you have to do in order to keep alveoli open. And you want to keep alveoli open. Who dies of atelectasis in the first 18 minutes of their traumatic brain injury? Nobody. But look at this in hemorrhagic shock. Actually, hallucinate this in hemorrhagic shock. This is a rat model where the rats were bled. They're in profound shock, okay? And this is a PEEP of 10. And this is survival. So they last about, I think this is 10 minutes. PEEP of 10. If you only have a PEEP of 5, ooh, they last for 15 minutes before they die. And this is a PEEP of 0, and they all survive to start the resuscitation. And except for one rat out of the 10, 90% of them all survive the resuscitation. No PEEP. Now, I thought PEEP was a really good thing. No, remember what PEEP does? It's all about venous return. Remember that? It's all about and if you're in TBI, it's all about perfusing the neuron. So positive pressure ventilation early, remember? You want them in an iron lung. PEEP is the opposite of an iron lung. It's keeping pressure higher and early in the resuscitation. Now, this is not evidence-based. Nobody knows for sure. Well, I guess, you know, you translate it from rats to humans, it makes sense. So PEEP's a bad one. Sorry you didn't ask that. I won't even get into this one because the hyperoxemia cult will go crazy, not having enough time to answer the questions. Okay, this is in 15,000 traumatic brain injury cases in the state of Arizona from the pre-implementation group of the EPIC study. Okay, so this is before we wiped out the three H-bombs, the aggressive prevention and treatment of hypotension, hypoxia, and hyper/overventilation, right? We prevent the three H-bombs. This is before the implementation of that, okay? This is the 15,000 cases in the pre-group. I don't need to get fancy here. All I'm looking is hypotension here is defined as if there's a single documented systolic pressure at any point in the pre-hospital setting under 90. Okay, that's hypotension. Hypoxia is a single documented saturation of less than 90 in the pre-hospital setting. So think about this. On average, the total pre-hospital interval from the time of arrival at the scene until arrival at the trauma center in non-transported, non-transferred patients, you ready for this in the state of Arizona? The mean is 18 minutes from arrival at the scene to arrival at the trauma center. In 18 minutes on average, if you have a single hypotensive episode in the field, the final outcome, mortality in the hospital, the unadjusted odds of likely of dying goes up by 440%. And even when you do the logistic regression, so you adjust for all the things that impact on the final outcome, mortality versus survival, a single pre-hospital hypotensive effect on average within the first 18 minutes of care increases the likelihood that the patient will die as the outcome by 250%. Remember what I keep saying? What you do dwarfs what the hospital does. Okay? Single hypoxic, it's an adjusted odds of 300% more likely of dying. One hypoxic event in the field. Think of between the time of that 18 minutes in the pre-hospital care, all the things that get done in a trauma center until the patient either is discharged or dies. On average, even the patients who die, die at about 3 days. Can you imagine that what you do in 18 minutes dwarfs what all the rest of the care is? Because the swings are massive. And here it is. If you get both hypoxia and hypotension, nobody's ever had large enough numbers in the past. The world literature until EPIC, the largest study, sorry, I'm gloating now. The largest study in the world literature that we could find had 14 patients with combined pre-hospital hypoxia and hypotension. You can't do a study with 14 patients. We now have over 300 in the pre-intervention group. Look at this. You are 600% more likely to die adjusted. In fact, unadjusted, it's 1,300% more likely to die if you have a hypotensive and hypoxic episode during the pre-hospital setting. So the reality is this is massive and huge. And by the way, it is worth saying, some of you have heard the hyperoxia cult talk about, oh no, what if they, what if we give them oxygen poisoning, right? This is a real key. You cannot hyperoxygenate in the pre-hospital environment. Let me do an asterisk because there's some air medical providers here. If you're 2.5 hours in and there's a transfer and you're flying 45 minutes and the patient's been intubated for 2 hours and everything's all sedated and you can hear the panpipe music, right, all that kind of stuff, of course, feel free to turn down from 100% FiO2 to, 50% FiO2 or whatever you're, feel free. Because the good news is now, even in the helicopter with end-tidal CO2 monitoring, you see the first breath when the tube comes out, right? So you don't have to be worried that you're going to have inadvertent, 10 minutes later, you're going to say, holy cow, the tube came out. Everybody else, you cannot hyperoxygenate in the pre-hospital setting. Here's what we teach in EPIC. If we could put a hyperbaric chamber in the back of the ambulance in TBI, we would. And here's why. 6.6, 3.0. In a person who's breathing room air, who is given succinylcholine, how long does a normal human being given succinylcholine, breathing room air, how long does it take for them to get to be hypoxic, a SAT less than 90? About 90 seconds in the typical adult. If you let them breathe 100% oxygen, you know, nobody can actually get there, but okay, whatever it is, 95%, trying to be 100% oxygen. If you let them breathe 100% oxygen for 3 minutes, and then you make them apneic, do you know how long it takes the average healthy person to become hypoxic? 8 minutes. Why? Because we have 20% oxygen in our lungs right now. You do 3 minutes of 100% breathing, they now have nearly 100% oxygen. I don't know about you, but I much prefer to not have a 90-second clock on my intubations. How about you? So the reality is we have a known risk. The way we say it is nobody can hyperoxygenate in the pre-hospital setting. What we're doing is we are pre-oxygenating to prevent the next disaster because we're going to do everything we possibly can to prevent hypoxia. And you know what? If 18 minutes of hyperoxygenation impacts the final outcome, I'll buy everybody lunch. It just doesn't matter. It's long periods in the ICU where you have to deal with oxygen toxicity. So everybody who's lost consciousness, high flow O2. Don't whine, don't complain. They may be the epidural who is in the lucid interval, who 5 minutes from now crash and you have to intubate. And I love 8 minutes, I hate 90 seconds. Okay, there's not time for questions.
You're way over.
I am. I'm way over. But you keep asking questions. It's his fault.
So much going on. One of the things that you had touched on is that there's going to be a trend before these things happen, and that you can kind of see the blood pressure going out before.
Oh, okay. Yes. The other thing that's really important.
Is induction medication.
Okay. Yes. Yes. Okay. Let me say this about sedation and pain control in your setting, right? Emergency resuscitation. I'll start with the conclusion. If you're really that worried that the patient will have a bad experience, then be a dentist or do concierge medicine. Okay? Here's why. Do you know how bad it is when you do something to the patient who has already got compromised brain flow potentially that causes venodilation and decreases venous return to the heart? Do you know in a normal patient, when you give IV Versed, a standard dose of IV Versed, in a normal healthy adult patient, their systolic blood pressure typically drops between 10 and 15 millimeters of mercury. What if they are in early stages of shock? Okay, so the reality is you're not there to prevent bad experiences. How we ever got into, oh, we want the patient to look really calm. We don't want them to have a bad experience. Ooh, they might spike their intracranial pressure. You know what? A spike in intracranial pressure is nothing compared to a decreased flow to the neuron. Okay? It's pretty much a non-issue. So be really careful with sedatives. One other thing. Some of you are thinking, it's no problem. I can reverse benzos and I can reverse narcotics. No, you can't. Remember, the CNS effects of narcotics and benzodiazepines are receptor-mediated in central nervous system receptors. So yeah, you can wake them back up, but the vascular effect on the veins and arteries is a direct effect. It is not receptor-mediated, so you cannot reverse the venodilation and the vasodilation that occurs. So give tiny doses, whatever's in your, sorry, like I say, I'm tenured, you can't do anything about it. Whatever's in your standing order, cheat, give a third. You can always give more, okay? This stuff is really important. Perfusing the brain is incredibly important. And you said one last thing.
I have no idea.
Good, then I've talked long enough. You didn't listen quickly enough. That was the problem. Take care.